Hello everyone. Namaste. Julie. When I say Julie, you may wonder what it means. It is a Ladakhi word which greets the people, welcomes the people. So today's special episode is on how to organize and manage a trip to Leh-Ladakh. Things to know before you visit Leh-Ladakh. And in this episode, I am going to give good tips on how to prepare yourself, how to travel, what all to take care of, and how to budget your travel when you visit Leh-Ladakh. Before that, first let me tell you that Ladakh is a cold desert. It is not like other terrain. It is not like big cities where you can simply plan a trip, book the ticket and go. Before going to Ladakh, you have to take care of certain things. First, you need to know what the topography and geography of Ladakh is. Ladakh is a barren desert where high mountain peaks, high mountain passes, very less greenery, a few rivers and a few lakes exist. Population is very less there, obviously due to the topography and the climate. It is extremely cold in winter and in summer it is hot, but the night temperatures are usually cold. To know about Ladakh, there are many blogs and blogs available on the net, but I found one Mr. Dheeraj Sharma's blog very informative. His educative video series on Ladakh impressed me very much. It was useful to me. And he covered the topic and guided the travelers from different walks of life, from the upper class, the middle class, the lower class, ones who travel by bus, ones who travel by car, ones who travel by taxi cab, ones who travel by their own self-driven car, ones who travel by motorcycles. So he has guidance for everyone. Dheeraj's blog is called discoverwithdheeraj.com and you can find it easily by searching Google. He also has a YouTube channel and he uploads quite informative content. Of late, he has started uploading vlogs on travel within Ladakh. I have been benefited by Dheeraj Sharma's vlogs, so I thought, why not highlight some of his vlogs in this episode, along with my own observations and my own experience during the Ladakh trip last year. The topics I am going to cover today are things to consider, tips to prevent AMS or acute mountain sickness, best itinerary by flight, Srinagar to Leh or Manali to Leh by road, clothes and things to carry, mobile phone connectivity, that's one of the most important things in modern times, shared taxis in Ladakh, budget friendly trip. I'm sure this will benefit most of the viewers because lot of middle class and lower middle class people, the wannabes who want to go to Ladakh on a shoestring budget, they'll be benefited by this. Then tips to save money. Yeah, again, self-planning or package, spot booking or pre-booking hotels. Then the last one, taking old age parents, pets, asthmatics and kids. These are all important topics. The most important topic. Then there are hundreds of other topics which we can cover that you can do by visiting Dheeraj Sharma's blog, Discover with Dheeraj, or visit his YouTube channel, Dheeraj Sharma, for his vlogs. Now the first part, things to consider before you go to Leh-Ladakh.
Julie friends, if you are new to my channel, my name is Dheeraj and I help people in planning memorable trips to the Himalayas. Well, while sharing these pointers to consider in the video, I'll try to be simple and realistic, taking into account thousands of people I communicate every season who goes for a Ladakh trip. I'm sure that there are many more things which one must consider, but for the brevity of this video, I've tried to outline the most important one. So, without any further delay, I'll right away jump into these important considerations, starting with the most important as number one, acute mountain sickness. Well, I have said so many times, no matter how fit you are in your homeland, you must consider acclimatization as the most crucial factor for a successful trip to Leh-Ladakh. Number two, breakdown in the middle of nowhere. On your Leh-Ladakh road trip, you will find many sections of the road barren and desolate with no hint of civilization. It is especially true in the Changthang region and almost about 300 kilometers of Manali Leh Highway, where it is difficult to spot settlement or shelter for food and stay. So you must be prepared for any kind of breakdown in the middle of nowhere. You should expect it to happen and you must have a contingency plan in place. Number 3. Lost connection with the world. Well, many parts of Ladakh and almost 3/4 of the Manali Leh Highway does not have any phone connectivity or any means to connect with your family or friends. You must consider that help will not be available just a phone call away, and hence you must plan and prepare yourself to survive for a few days on your own. Number 4. Flash floods, landslides, snow slides or shooting stones. Well, all of these are the part of day-to-day lives of the Himalayas, including Ladakh and Zanskar Valley. One must always expect to witness hardships or getting stuck for few days due to any of these natural events. These events happen in the Himalayas often enough. Your trip can be delayed, cancelled or extended by any of these events. Hence, whenever you plan for Ladakh trip, you must always plan to keep a day or two as buffer days. Number 5. Drive and ride with caution and care. Well, you must be a very good driver or rider in the plains, but the roads in Ladakh or other parts of Trans-Himalayas are nothing like those roads in the plain. Example, the faster you drive, the sicker the car passengers may feel in the curvy roads up there. The margin of error is minimal and lapse in concentration can cost many lives. Due to loose gravel or ice on the roads, falling while riding is pretty common because people are so used to applying front brakes on the bike. Number 6. Availability of medical facilities. When traveling in Ladakh, medical help can be more than a day away. It is your best interest to not to plan a trip on Ladakh if you are having any kind of pre-existing medical symptoms. Even untreated diarrhea can be fatal in Ladakh. Hence, do not take any health symptoms lightly. You may be used to neglect it in your hometown where the pharmacist or a doctor lives next door in most lanes in your city. However, it is not true when you travel to the remote corners of the Trans-Himalayas, including places like Ladakh or Zanskar Valley. I always recommend carrying a basic medical kit with you and a consultation with your doctor before your Ladakh trip starts. And last but not the least, point number 7, you might end up losing your soul forever in Ladakh. Like I have already said for myself, ever since I went to Ladakh about a decade back, it is the mere mortal body of mine that has returned. My soul has been lost somewhere up in that heavenly place forever. Every day I wish I could go back to the heaven in search of the soul and bring it back. However, I always overlook the fact that some things in this world are still impossible, and bringing back your soul from the heaven is one of them. Well, enough of the personal feelings. The point is that each time you visit Ladakh, you will fall more and more in love with the place, people and culture of Ladakh, no matter how harsh or tough the terrain is to survive. It is nothing but the magic of this place. All my heart always says there is no other place in the world like Ladakh.
First thing I considered was my age. I am 67 years old. And how can I manage alone going that far from my hometown, which is over 3000 kilometers? So first you have to consider, if you are in a remote part of India and if you want to reach Leh, which is the nearest point from where you can take off. So I chose Delhi as the base. To travel from Mangalore to Delhi, it takes about 35 to 40 hours by super fast train. There was a direct flight available from Mangalore by Indigo Airlines. I chose that and took the flight from Mangalore to Delhi. So that flight covered within 3 hours and I was in Delhi. Then after going to Delhi, where you are going to stay? It depends on your budget again. In Delhi, there are many options. I stayed in a dormitory accommodation near Interstate Bus Terminal, Kashmir Gate, AC homestay dormitory, which provided a clean bed and clean toilet, which was shared commonly by about 10 or 12 people in a dormitory. And that cost me only 500 rupees per night. From Delhi, I took another flight because the road trip was not possible through Manali. So what I did was I took a flight from Delhi to Leh. It was a short flight and reached Leh within an hour or so. It flew over the Himalayas and it was a breathtaking view. So I could enjoy my flight as well. After reaching Leh, I stayed in a hostel, a dormitory room again, which cost me around 500 again per night. So I had a lot of time in my hand because before I could go on my tour, the package by Thomas Cook, I had about 3 or 4 days at my disposal. So I spent the 3 nights initially in Leh, went around and acclimatized myself. So here comes the point, acclimatization. Acclimatization is important because to overcome acute mountain sickness, you need to be at a lower altitude for at least 48 hours. And Leh is around 11,000 feet above mean sea level. And that is ideal to get acclimatized if you go by flight and reach Leh. If you go by road, if you take the road from Srinagar to Leh, then on the way, you automatically get acclimatized because it is a gradual rise from lower altitude to higher altitude. And the journey takes about 12 hours. And you will be stopping at many places. So if you travel by road from Srinagar to Leh, you can get acclimatized only for 24 hours and start your journey within Ladakh.
Well, Ladakh, Spiti Valley or Zanskar Valley are high altitude places in Trans-Himalayas. And when you make a trip up there, acute mountain sickness is always on the cards. The majority of people suffer from AMS symptoms knowingly or unknowingly. Some people have mild symptoms and others may have severe symptoms. You know, it is biology and one cannot trick it or defeat it. If you are not following the basic acclimatization principles, that is to give time and allow your body to adjust to high altitude, you are bound to suffer with AMS symptoms. Generally, people can go up to 8,000 feet without much problems of mountain sickness. As you start to increase the altitude, the barometric pressure starts to decrease, which reduces the oxygen level per breath. Hence, people start to suffer from AMS or acute mountain sickness as the body does not adapt to the high altitude or change in the altitude. But what is high altitude? Generally, people define high altitude as anywhere to be between 8,000 feet to 12,000 feet. Between 12,000 feet to 18,000 feet, it is more or less very high altitude, and above 18,000 feet, it is extremely high altitude. Today, in this video, I'm going to share some of the tips that will help you minimize the symptoms of AMS and help you better acclimatize whenever you are traveling to places like Ladakh, Spiti Valley or Zanskar Valley. Number 1. Increase the altitude gradually when you travel to these places. The acclimatization rule says that after 10,000 feet, you must stay overnight for every 1,000 feet of elevation to properly acclimatize your body. You should also allow a whole day acclimatization rest after 3,000 feet with an overnight stay at the same altitude. In general, due to lack of leaves, many people are not able to follow this principle. Second, keep your body adequately hydrated. Do take plenty of water intake with ORS or fluids like milk tea, juices, soup with garlic, garlic flavored water, etc. Adequate hydration will help you keep the oxygen level standard in the body. Also, you should avoid too much of black tea or black coffee as well. Number 3. Avoid overhydration. Too much water is harmful and can dilute your body's sodium levels. So, have your body adequately hydrated. Number 4. Avoid sleeping at high altitude as much as possible. Sleeping decreases the respiratory drive of our body. It is recommended that you travel to high altitude in the day, but whenever you want to sleep, come back to a lower altitude and sleep. Number 5. Avoid overexertion. Do not exert your body with any additional physical activity, especially in the initial days when your body is getting adapted to the high altitude. Physical activity will lead you to pump more breath, so it will get more difficult as your body is not acclimatized to that altitude. Number 6. Avoid tobacco, smoking or alcohol or any other depressant drugs that you might be taking. All these things will further decrease the respiratory drive during the sleep, resulting in worsening the AMS symptoms. So it is highly recommended that you avoid these things whenever traveling to high altitude places like Ladakh, Spiti Valley or Zanskar Valley. Number 7. Keep your body warm with woolens. Make sure your clothes are always dry. Number 8. Eat lots of carbohydrates as your body needs energy. Chocolates and energy bars are some excellent sources. Number 9. Try not to sleep during the day and keep yourself busy with some light activity. Respiration decreases during sleep, which further aggravates the AMS symptoms. So it is better, unless your body is acclimatized to the high altitude, you avoid sleeping in the daytime and indulge in some light activity. Number 10. If you are having some difficulty in sleeping, try to sleep in upright position. Number 11, carry some preventive medicines for AMS. Always consult your doctor, because taking these preventive AMS medicines can cause side effects. So it is always highly recommended that you do not take them without doctor's prescription. Number 12, you can carry a small oxygen cylinder kit as well. It will help you counter AMS symptoms as a supplement. And if you are badly stuck with AMS, then it can also buy you time before you descend to a lower altitude place. Number 13, immediately descend if your symptom increases. Traveling to the low altitude is the only cure in some conditions when the symptoms have reached moderate levels or are not improving. In case you feel a person in your group or you yourself are suffering badly, then please ask him to walk in a straight line. If you see that he cannot walk properly in a straight line, then it is time to immediately descend. All these 13 tips will help you minimize the AMS symptoms. However, there is one important point to note. The best cure to AMS is acclimatize properly or descend to a lower altitude if your symptoms are not improving.
So for me, 48 hours was required. I laid down, took rest, consumed a lot of water, had absolutely no symptoms, no headache, no giddiness, no dehydration, no nausea, nothing. I was absolutely fine. So much for tips to prevent acute mountain sickness. Then best itinerary by flight. Flights to Leh don't cost much if you book in advance. If you book in, say, 4 or 6 months in advance, you may get a lot of concession. Then again, during high season, that is in summer, the flight prices go up, and during monsoons, they come down a little bit. In winter, they come down further. Flights operate almost throughout the year, but getting accommodation in Leh or Ladakh or moving around in Leh and Ladakh is difficult during winter because it will be covered in snow only, and most of the hotels and restaurants will be closed. So visiting Ladakh in winter can be at your own discretion. In other seasons, say from March or April till November is recommended, and you will enjoy it more.
I would suggest a 8 to 9 days itinerary for your Leh Ladakh trip by air. You can modify this itinerary and cut off the places that you are not interested in. So, day one would be simply flying to Leh. Many hotels provide you a free pickup and drop to airport, so do ask your hotel before you book there. Secondly, you need to take ample of rest. You need to keep your body hydrated throughout the day. Do not overexert yourself. Do not take too many stairs up and down. Just relax and avoid sleeping in the daytime. It will help your body adapt to the high altitude, but the key is to keep your body hydrated and less exerted. In the evening, what you can do is explore Leh local market, or maybe go to Shanti Stupa at the top and have an aerial view of Leh town. While coming back to your hotel, you can basically have a nice dinner at some restaurant at Chang Spa Road. Now day two is all about Leh local sightseeing and getting the inner line permits. You need inner line permits to visit inner line areas of Ladakh, which are Nubra Valley, Pangong So and Somorri. If you are feeling okay, then do local sightseeing in Leh, which can include Hall of Fame, visiting Leh Palace, Sankar Gompa, visit Leh local market and Datun Sahib, explore some restaurants around Chang Spa Road, stroll in the main market, do some shopping. All these things you can do as a part of your Leh local sightseeing. Alternatively, you can visit Sham Valley as well. That would include sightseeing to Indus and Zanskar confluence, Gurdwara Pathar Sahib, Magnetic Hills, Alchi Monastery, Likir Monastery and Basgo Plains. This will require a whole day and you can come back to Leh for overnight stay. Now day 3. On day 3, you will be heading to Khardungla Pass and further to Nubra Valley. Start your day early and cross Khardungla Pass. I would highly recommend that you do not stay at Khardungla Pass for more than 10-12 minutes. On this day, once you reach Nubra Valley, you can visit Diskit, which has monastery with the tallest Buddha statue. And then in the evening, go for sand dunes in Hunder. You can have like bacterian camel or double humped camel safari as well over there. Now day 4. On day 4, you can travel from Hunder, Diskit, Sumur, Penamik, Khardungla and back to Leh. So So Sumur has a famous monastery that you can check out, and Panamik has a hot water spring along with a lake called Yarapso. It is a small wish pond that locals use to make wishes, but if you like, you can go ahead and have a hike to it. Now comes day 5. On day 5, you would be traveling from Leh to Pangongso. However, you can cover either of Hemis, Thikske or She Monastery on the way to Pangongso. And then like you can spend all the time at Pangongso. You can spend some time while going to Pangongso at Changla Pass. There are a couple of lakes that also comes in between. And just relax at Pangongso and enjoy the beauty of it. Next day, which is day 6, you would follow the journey back to Leh from Pangongso. Or you can visit again like Thikske Monastery or She Palace while coming back. So a journey from Leh to Pangong and Pangong to Leh, one side it will take you about 5 or 6 hours. So this ends day 6 for you. If you do not have more days at hand, what you can do is you can fly back home and end your trip. Or if you have more days at hand, at least a couple of days, then I would recommend that you try and go for a 2-day trip to Somuri. Somuri is a beautiful lake. Personally, I prefer it more than Pangongso, especially because of its desolate route and less number of tourists over there. So how you can make it, like you can go from Leh on day 7 and follow the route towards Chumathang via Upshi, and then take the Mahe Bridge and go over to Somuri. You can sleep overnight at Somuri, relax over there, spend some time around the lake. And next day, what you can do on day 8 is take the route from Sokar Lake, like from Somuri, you can take a route to Sokar Lake. If you are a fan of birds, then you will be able to spot some nice birds around Sokar Lake. From Sokar Lake, you can exit to Manali Leh Highway and come back via Tanglanga Pass towards Leh. So this will help you cover some exciting portion of Manali Leh Highway as well. And the journey is like really, really beautiful. Again, if you do not have more than 8 days, then fly back on day 9 and return home. That calls for the whole, you know, Sunday to Sunday week's trip over 9 days. Now, are you interested in saving a day? Well, yes, you can save a day by taking a direct route from Nubra Valley to Pangongso on day 4 and return back on day 5 to Leh. So this will help you save one more day. Alternatively, you can also do a day trip to Pangongso. So what you can do with that saved day? Either you have less number of days and you can adjust the itinerary accordingly, or I would highly recommend that saved day you should spend in Nubra Valley and visit one of the most beautiful villages out there called Turtuk. Now this finishes everything I wanted to tell you about a perfect itinerary to Leh Ladakh by air.
Srinagar to Leh or Manali to Leh by road.
So Srinagar Leh Highway versus Manali Leh Highway. If you are doing a full circuit, I will always recommend that you plan your trip to Ladakh from Srinagar Leh Highway and come back from Manali Leh Highway. But why? Firstly, it is much easier on your body and help you acclimatize to the high altitude of Manali Leh Highway on your return journey. Secondly, it allows you to enjoy the beauty of Manali Leh Highway by splitting the journey now almost evenly with night halt at Sarchu. It is difficult to sleep at Sarchu when you travel from Manali side. So I always recommend that when you travel from Leh to Manali, then only sleep at Sarchu, because your body is already acclimatized to the high altitude. Now thirdly, it will also allow you to fit the Somuri Lake into your itinerary in much better way when returning home via Manali Leh Highway, because you can travel to Somuri from Leh and then exit on Manali Leh Highway via Somuri. And finally, you do not need to worry about Rohtang Pass permits, because there are no permits required when you travel from Keelong to Manali. So these were 4 reasons why you should always travel from Srinagar side than from Manali side. But what could be the reasons for choosing Manali Leh over Srinagar? Well, let's talk about it. Firstly, if you have less number of days, then of course going via Manali Leh Highway will help you save at least one day. Secondly, If you're okay in riding or driving for longer hours, then you can go via Manali Leh Highway, because you would need to undertake the journey from Kelong to Leh or Jispa to Leh, which is about 12 hours of drive or ride. It will help you avoid sleeping at Sarchu and help you avoid the AMS early in your trip. Thirdly, if you're traveling by public transport, you can choose to travel via Manali Leh, because there are so many buses which are connected from Delhi to Manali and then from Manali to Leh. Both Himachal Tourism as well as Himachal Roadways, they run these buses between Delhi and Manali and Manali and Leh. Even HPTDC, which is Himachal Tourism, they run a semi-deluxe bus which also provides you accommodation at Kelong. Finally, if you are afraid of traveling via Srinagar side due to unrest in the valley or road closure or some other concerns, then of course the only option to travel to Leh is Leh Manali Highway.
Then clothes and things to carry. Like I said, Ladakh is a cold desert. So most of the year, in the nights especially, it will be cold. So you need light woolens anytime when you travel to Leh. So you need to cover your head, cover your face, cover your neck, then cover your body with a jacket, thermal jacket, and cover your feet with shoes and woolen socks if you need, or even synthetic or cotton socks will do in summer and rainy season. In autumn and winter, you need heavy winter clothing, so layers of dress will help you. So that you may need to carry, which means your luggage will be expanded.
Hello friends, one of the most common questions many people ask me is about what clothes should they carry on Ladakh trip. Of course, mainly it depends upon the season that you want to travel and how much sensitive you are to cold. But still, some basic guidelines will surely help you to pack the right balance of clothes on your upcoming Ladakh trip. Well, carrying clothes on a Ladakh trip mainly depends upon the season or month in which you will be traveling to high altitude place. The winters may have altogether different requirements than summers. While the shoulder season months of April to May and September to October may prove to be very tricky ones, the peak season months of June, July and August are considered to be pleasant, where light woolens will mostly do the job for you. In winter months, when both Manali Leh Highway and Srinagar Leh Highway are closed due to heavy snow, then conditions are extremely cold and you need to go well prepared according to them. Hence, in winter months of November to March, proper gear including heavy woolens are required to survive on a Leh-Ladakh road trip. Now let's talk about the tricky months of visiting Ladakh, which are April to May and September-October. This is where most people make mistakes. It is mostly because in plains of India, these months are either pretty hot or somewhat pleasant. Hence, people don't pay much attention that a high altitude region, things can be completely different and winter-like conditions could be there. So let's talk about some general guidelines that you must follow when packing your clothes for a Ladakh trip. Firstly, the basic thing for making a Ladakh trip successful one is that at any cost, you must keep yourself warm enough. Keeping you warm will help you acclimatize faster and in a better way. Hence, especially in the shoulder months, you should wear proper warm layers of clothing and protect your feet as well with shoes. Secondly, you should carry clothes that you can wear in layers. Why? Because that will help you adjust to the fluctuating temperatures in the sun and shade, or if there are overcast conditions. Especially at the starting and ending months of Ladakh season, when the sun is shining, then everything appears good and pleasant. But as soon as you enter shaded portion or there are some little overcast conditions, it becomes cold enough pretty quickly. So you need to have a jacket handy with you so that you can quickly wear it as soon as the conditions become cold. This will help you keep warm and avoid letting the cold flow inside your body. Keeping these factors in mind, I recommend that you carry following winter clothes for your Ladakh trip. First thing, couple of pairs of inner thermal suits, as they will help you in layering. Secondly, carry a heavy woolen jacket always with you throughout the year. Weather can change suddenly in high altitude places like Ladakh or Spiti Valley, so you need to make sure that you carry a heavy woolen jacket even if you don't need to use it throughout the trip. But if you do, please thank me later. Number 3, always carry a pair of woolen socks with a good pair of insulated boots or trekking shoes with you. Especially in winters, you should have insulated boots or trekking shoes that can keep your feet warm enough. In summers, even sports shoes work fine, but I always prefer hiking boots which protect my ankle when traveling to mountains. Number 4, carry at least couple of caps to protect yourself from direct sunlight, as it is quite harsh in this region. Kids especially should wear caps or hats all the time when they're out playing in the sun. Especially in the months of September and October, the UV rays are harshest and you must protect your skin using hats, cap or some good high SPF sunscreen lotion. Number 5, carry a balaclava or a monkey cap that will certainly help you in cold conditions which are set up suddenly. Number 6, you should carry sunglasses to protect your eyes from the reflecting snow in the mountains. Number 7, hand gloves is a must have in case you are traveling in the months of October to May or especially if you are riding. Number 8, an extra pair of shoes or gumboots in case you are riding on a bike and you are expecting a lot of water crossing on the way. It is always nice to carry some candies, chocolates, books, pen, pencils, crayons, etc. Anything that you can distribute among the local children up there. Nothing but the smile on their face would be totally worth it.
Mobile phone connectivity. Well, Ladakh is a highly secure place and it has Indo-China border and Indo-Pak border, where our armed forces have set up many camps. So, mobile signal is restricted in certain areas due to that. And you may not get a clear signal in some remote places. So, you need to study that, where you get a strong signal, where you don't get, from where you can make phone calls, but the data is not available. All these things you can study, and Dheeraj's log will help you to understand that. For example, when we went to Pangong Lake, my Airtel didn't work there, but my travel mates, they had a BSNL SIM and that was working there. So some phones may work, some may not work in some places.
Hello friends, a lot of people ask me about which mobile phone networks work in Ladakh, which of them have the best network coverage and which SIM card they should carry on Leh-Ladakh road trip. In the last video, I did talk about that prepaid mobile phone connection outside Leh-Ladakh region do not work in Ladakh. Jammu and Kashmir does not allow outside state prepaid connections, and since Ladakh now has become union territory, I have not seen any update or change in it. And maybe in years to come, that might change. But for now, the postpaid connections for MTNL and BSNL or Airtel do work in Leh-Ladakh. If you ask me the quality of connections, well, Airtel is the best in Leh-Ladakh region, but the coverage of Airtel connection is pretty much confined to Leh town and its vicinity. Hence, when you need a wide coverage within Ladakh, then BSNL and MTNL connections have the widest coverage. Therefore, I highly recommend that you carry a BSNL or MTNL postpaid connection with you on your Leh-Ladakh road trip. Mobile phone connectivity in Leh-Ladakh region is fairly limited to Leh town and Nubra Valley. There is some limited connectivity at Hanle village, as well as some connectivity has been spotted at the Lukung village near Pangongso Lake. However, many times in these remote places, the connection does not seem to work. So I believe it will take some time to get it stabilized at Pangongso and Hanle. So Murray Lake on the other hand does not have any connectivity whatsoever. The last place where you will get some mobile phone connectivity towards Somorri is Chumathang village. On Srinagar Leh highway, you will get signals up to Sonmar, then once you reach Dras and then finally Kargil. When you leave Kargil, you will get some mobile phone connectivity at Lamayuru, and then finally when you are about to reach Leh, Nimu or Sham Valley. Stretches in between these places do not have any connectivity on Srinagar Leh highway. Similarly, on Manali Leh highway, you will get mobile phone signals up to Kelong and then further at Jispa as well as Darcha as well. But once you leave Jispa or Darcha, the mobile phone connectivity is lost for the rest of the Manali Leh highway. Hence, there is no connectivity at places like Sarchu or Pang. So it becomes very important that you inform your loved ones back at home whenever you get an opportunity to contact them before leaving for the day or after reaching your destination. So please drop your whereabouts whenever you get an opportunity or network anywhere in Ladakh region. They will be less worried back at home. Now let us talk about some of the frequently asked questions about various network providers which people often ask me. Question number 1, does Jio SIM card work on Leh-Ladakh road trip? Well, as of 2018, Jio had installed few towers in Leh-Ladakh and connectivity has started in Ladakh region. The internet data connectivity speed of Reliance Jio is very fast and you can rely on it wherever the connectivity is there. Reliance Jio is also planning to provide mobile phone connectivity up to Turtuk village in Nubra Valley and also Sarchu on Manali Leh highway. Question number 2, does Vodafone's phone connection work in Leh-Ladakh road trip? Well, in my experience, no, Vodafone connections does not work in Leh-Ladakh. However, on some of my trips, I have seen that sometimes the Vodafone connection works with other mobile phone service providers. So these were some of the commonly asked questions about various network providers apart from what I have already covered in this video. And this concludes my two-part series on mobile phone connectivity in Leh-Ladakh. I hope by now you are familiar with what and where to expect mobile phone connectivity in Leh-Ladakh.
Then about shared taxi in Ladakh. Well, this is an economical way to go around, because in Ladakh, there are not many buses available from point to point. For example, from Leh to Pangong, there are not regular buses. From Leh to Nubra Valley, maybe one bus runs in a day, twice in a week or once in a week, sometimes on a designated day in a month. So you cannot take chances and you cannot design your holiday according to that. So better to depend on shared taxis. Leh Taxi Cooperative Union is there. Ladakh Taxi Union. They have an office in Leh where you can find out about shared taxis. And even in some restaurants, public places where people meet and mingle. And in the hostels, hotels, people put flyers through which you can come to know that who is traveling where, and you can join them and share the taxi. So that facility is awesome in Leh. It costs you a bit more, but it is inevitable. You have to make use of that. No other goal.
Are you looking for a shared taxi in Ladakh to save cost on your trip? Or are you a solo traveler or a couple who would like to share the high taxi cost in Ladakh? Time to time, solo travelers or backpackers reach out to me asking about how to avail public transport in Ladakh, or where they can find groups to share taxi costs, or how can they reduce the overall budget of their transport costs in Ladakh trip. Well, public transport is not readily available and it is not that frequent to various sightseeing places in Ladakh. If you are traveling to Ladakh and you are alone, or like a solo traveler or a backpacker, or you are a couple, the taxi charges in Leh Ladakh trip can make some very deep hole in your pockets. The private taxis are very costly, but you will be able to find shared taxis in Ladakh without much fuss at all. There are few different types of shared taxis, like tourist shared taxis, local shared taxis, and taxis which are run by travel agents. Let's look at them one by one and how they are different from each other. Firstly, you should understand that tourist shared taxis are those where travelers or tourists like you get together and form a group. Then they get in touch with the taxi driver, or they already have got in touch with the taxi driver, and then what they do is they split the cost of the entire taxi code that they have got evenly among each other. However, in this case, the itinerary needs to match among the group members. You are completely free to stop these taxis at any places on the route for sightseeing in the entire trip. As long as the group has synergy and agreement, it is the best option to stop anywhere for taking any pictures or soaking in the nature in Ladakh. In this option, you are free to choose the group size based upon your comfort levels of not overcrowding it. Secondly, various travel agents also run these shared tourist taxis to places like Nubra Valley, Pangong, So, Manali to Leh, or Srinagar to Leh. You pay per person for a seat in these taxis, and they run on some schedule based on how the travel agent wants to run them. The taxi driver and the agent will have a predefined set of stops on the route with limited flexibilities when you can stop to click pictures. But frankly speaking, it all comes down to the group and the synergy with the driver. Cost-wise, these are a little on a higher side than what you will pay usually when sharing the taxi cost evenly among your group. It is mainly because the local taxi driver who can give discounts on the taxi union rates, while the travel agent will charge the taxi union rates, and on top of it, there'll be some premium as well. Usually the range of these destination-based trips from travel agent is somewhere between ₹1800 to ₹2500. The occupancy in these taxis are limited to provide the comfort based upon the taxi size as well as the tempo traveler. Thirdly, you have the option to avail the local shared taxis, which are much like a public transport, like shared jeeps or autos in other parts of India. These local shared taxis are used by locals to commute from one place to another in Ladakh. These taxis run from point to point, one place to another, without any sightseeing whatsoever in the middle. They may stop for some food breaks or snack breaks, but not at the places where you might want to take a picture in the middle of anywhere. Also, these local taxis are fairly limited to the local populated areas or villages. For example, you may not get a local shared taxis to run from Leh to Pangong So, because there will be less locals willing to go over there. However, you will be able to easily find these taxis which are shared by locals to go to places like Nubra Valley or Srinagar from Leh or Manali from Leh. These taxis may not be flexible, but these are the cheapest forms of taxis that you can avail in Ladakh, as you pay per seat sharing with some locals. However, they can get very crowded as driver would want more passengers in the taxi to run from one place to another. Hence, I advise you to choose these taxis only when you are very tight on budget and you can give up on the flexibility of stopping in the middle of anywhere to take pictures. Of course, you want to also give up on some level of comfort as well. Now comes the part, how can you get these shared taxis in Ladakh? Well, firstly, if you are looking for a tourist shared taxi, then there are lots of flyers that people put on cafes, dine-ins, restaurants, travel agent desks, or shops, or whiteboards all over in the Leh market or Fort Road area. These people are looking to share taxis for different trips, and you can get connected with them to share the cost. As someone will be anchoring these taxis and the group, so you will need to get in touch with those folks in order to avail these taxis. Or you can yourself talk to a local taxi driver and get a quote from him and then start forming a group. You can also put some flyers out there at such places to form this group. And this way, you will be the anchor of the group. Secondly, like I said before, even travel agents organize such tourist shared taxi trips as well. They may charge a little higher, about rupees 200 to 300 more than it would ideally cost by splitting the cost of taxi evenly in your own group. So in worst case, you can always go back to them and book a seat for yourself on such shared sightseeing tours. In any case, this will also save you some good amount of money on your Ladakh trip. Finally, the local run shared taxis are available at Leh taxi stand or Srinagar taxi stand or Manali taxi stand, or you can find them in the main markets of some villages like Diskit in Nubra Valley. Alright, now that you understand your options and how to avail these shared taxis, you might also be thinking, how difficult is it to get these shared taxis? Is it too much of a hassle for you? Well friends, gelling up with people in Ladakh is more or less easy because many people travel solo and look forward to meeting other people. They want to share cultural thoughts or values over these trips. They also want to travel to other places in Ladakh and save some money. So in season time from May to September, you will be easily able to find some shared taxis for tourists in Ladakh. One thing is very sure, nowhere else in the world you will find more helping people and smiling people as Ladakhis are. But in worst case, if you are unable to form a group or get a shared taxi, then you can hop on to a local shared taxi and do your trip. However, you already know the disadvantages of using a local shared taxi. So take a call accordingly. Please note that in off season, you will only be at the mercy of these local shared taxis that run, and you will not be able to find much of shared tourist taxis because the tourist rush is low. Now lastly, you may be thinking, if you can find such travel partners online who are ready to share the taxi costs. Well yes, absolutely, you can also find online travel partners to share taxi costs on your Ladakh trip. Various travel forums like IndiaMile have dedicated travel partner section where you can look out for other people. Even Devil on Wheels forum used to have a travel partner section, but unfortunately I have to shut it down the forums due to various other reasons. But you can also check the Devil on Wheels travel calendar, link in the description of this video. I enable it in season time and you will get hundreds of entries of the people who are looking out for travel partners in that calendar. In my opinion, it is a very good tool for finding travel partners online for your Himalayan trips. You can easily filter the entries based on your own preferences and increase the chances of visibility. Hence, kindly explore the DOW travel calendar that I have linked in the description of this video and also post your entry too. This calendar will help you find travelers who are looking for a company and increase the probability of finding your host by others too. So this was all about the shared taxis in Ladakh, the various types of them and how you can avail them. I'm sure all this will help you save some cost on your upcoming Ladakh trip.
And about budget-friendly trip. Well, budget-friendly trip depends on how you plan it again. If you stay in hostels and eat food in small eateries, then you can save a lot. Travel again, like I said, travel by bus. If you plan it properly, then you can do it. Otherwise, you can do hitchhiking, and some people oblige and take you on their motorbike or in their car. So there are people traveling for free within Ladakh. Maybe a nominal amount if you spend for them, like, you know, if you offer them some snacks or meals as a gesture, then that may cost you a little bit. But that saves a lot of your money rather than spending on shared taxi or engaging a taxi yourself. So consider that. Dheeraj has his own tips for you.
Friends, are you planning a budget trip to Ladakh and wondering how can you plan such a trip to this remotest region of the Himalayas? Well, the short answer to the question is yes, you can make a budget trip to Leh Ladakh or at least save some money on this trip. And I will share 7 tips on how to do it. So let's check them out one by one. Number 1. Travel in the shoulder season months, which are like April and May and September and October. Traveling in the less touristy season has its own advantages and disadvantages. And there are 3 reasons this could work out for you. A. Spot bookings, which will reduce the overall cost. B. Discounts and offers due to the fewer tourists. And C. The rush at the best tourist spots is much lesser in these shoulder months. You don't need to search for any Leh Ladakh budget tour packages. Instead, the cost of Leh Ladakh trip will reduce in the shoulder season automatically. Secondly, commute and stay in group of 3 to 5 people. Well, if I talk about accommodation costs only, then traveling in this optimal group size brings down the cost of the rooms to bare minimum. Concerning about the commute, a complete taxi could be hired and the whole group, which is of 5 people, can share the taxi cost evenly. You can consider hiring a tempo traveler if the group size is much more significant. Self-drive ride in your own vehicle or bike is the cheapest and most flexible option out there, and camping in Ladakh is another good option to reduce the overall cost. Number 3. Find some on-the-spot deals for accommodation and taxis. Well, with the on-spot booking, the cost will always comes down. Booking online or over the phone is still always costlier. You could also inspect the room before you book it, especially if you have some time to do it. Booking on the spot also brings flexibility in your itinerary as well. Contacting to taxi drivers directly would usually get a very good deal in terms of commute option. And do not forget to leave early and sleep early principle, which I always talk about. Because what happens is, when you reach later in the day, you have less margin for negotiations. Point number 4. Wisely choose your accommodation option and its location. Well, consider living in a guest house or a homestay option in Ladakh, which are also now well versed with cleanliness, comfortable beds and western toilets, though sometimes these are shared ones. In order to find decent yet economic places to stay in Manali, you can stay at Old Manali, Manali Nagar Road or Vashisht. Similarly, Leh has full of such small budget guest houses, which are available at Upper Tuksha Road, Fort Road, some clusters are there near Main Market, Zangsti Road, etc. You can always refer some of the cheapest options that I have mentioned in the description of this video. Similarly, point number 5, wisely choose your places to eat as well. If you eat at some local dhaba, then along with saving some good amount of money, you also give yourself a chance to taste local food as well as fresh food in general. You should try and give yourself a chance to eat local Ladakhi or Tibetan home-cooked meal at such local eating joints. It does not mean that you don't eat at good restaurants, but all I'm trying to say over here is that you should make a mix of both to balance out the budget. And just extending on these 5 tips, number 6, you can pay for individual meals as well. Well, though in a group of friends, sometimes it looks odd in a country like ours, but it is quite common to pay on the table individually and there is nothing wrong in it at all. Well, I know things can get a little messy in this case, and if you are not used to it or people in the group are not so proactive, but if done correctly, it helps in saving some money. And lastly, point number 7, if you are traveling to Leh Ladakh by air, then you should plan your trip well in advance. Air tickets to Leh Ladakh in the season time are crazily high. But if you are planning well in advance, you can always keep a lookout for those flash sales from SpiceJet, Indigo or GoAir. So friends, this was all about the tips that you can follow to save some money on your budget trip to Leh Ladakh. I hope you found them useful.
Then the 9th one, tips to save money. Again, that's the same thing. How to economize on your travel?
Well, budget is an integral part of any trip, but it becomes very critical when you make a trip to Ladakh because of high number of days required to even make a basic trip up there. And it is a simple math. More the number of days, more will be the cost of food and stay. Now, combining it with the fact that self-drive cars are not allowed for sightseeing in Ladakh, most people are left to opt for taxis whose rates are considerably high due to rough terrain, bad roads and a short tourist season window in Ladakh. Well, before we dive deeper into the topic, let us set some basic ground rules. Firstly, in order to help you understand better, I'll outline an example Ladakh trip itinerary that covers the entire circuit from Delhi to Srinagar to Leh to Nubra Valley, Pangong So, Somori and Manali. Secondly, I'll follow a mix and match approach of using public transport in Ladakh as well as shared tourist taxis. At some part of this plan, I'll also share some other available transport options for you. Thirdly, I'm assuming that since you are on a budget trip to Ladakh, you will be finding places on the spot and you'll not be pre-booking them, as advanced booking end up mostly being costly. And finally, all the cost of accommodation that I'll use in the calculations are on twin sharing basis. Now let us start with day 1, where you'll be traveling from Delhi to Jammu. There are buses available between Delhi-Jammu that cost around Rs 700, as well as between Delhi-Srinagar, where sleeper buses cost around Rs 1900 and non-sleeper one cost around Rs 1700. However, the most economic way to travel from Delhi to Jammu is by train. You need to pay around Rs 450 for sleeper class in train and Rs 1100 for a 30-year AC. So, the cost of travel for day 1 should be around Rs 450 by sleeper class in train. Now for the cost of stay, you will find many budget guest houses and stays near the bus stand at Jammu ranging from Rs 800 to Rs 1200. So you can consider Rs 400 to 500 for a stay in Jammu at double sharing basis. Hence, at the end of day 1, the total cost spent on transport and accommodation is Rs 850 to Rs 950. Now on second day, you will be traveling from Jammu to Srinagar, where you will find plenty of buses running between these two places. The cost ranges from Rs 750 for tempo travelers to Rs 600 for semi-deluxe buses and to Rs 550 for ordinary state transport buses. Finding shared taxis from Jammu to Srinagar is quite easy from Gumma taxi stand. The shared taxi costs around Rs 1000 per person per seat. So the cost of travel on day 2 is Rs 550 by state transport bus. Now for the cost of stay, you will find many budget guest houses and stays near Nagin Lake or Dal Lake or at the backside of Dal Lake ranging from Rs 900 to Rs 1200. So you can consider Rs 450 to 500 for a stay in Srinagar. Hence, at the end of day 2, the total transport and accommodation cost is Rs 1850 to Rs 2000. Now on day 3, you will be travelling from Srinagar to Kargil, and there are plenty of shared taxis as well as daily buses that are available to run between these two places. Shared taxis to Leh from Srinagar cost around Rs 1800 with a night stop at Kargil. However, there is a direct semi-deluxe bus as well that runs from Srinagar to Leh, which costs about Rs 800, and for a deluxe bus, it costs around Rs 1400. These buses will stop overnight at Kargil. So the cost of travel for day 2 is Rs 800 for Srinagar to Leh by semi-deluxe bus. Now for the cost of stay, you can easily find a guest house in Kargil ranging from Rs 800 to Rs 1000. So you can consider Rs 400 to 500 for a stay in Kargil. Hence, at the end of day 3, the total expenses of transport and accommodation is Rs 3050 to Rs 3300. On day 4, you will be travelling from Kargil to Leh, and there are plenty of shared taxis and daily buses of JKSRTC that run between Kargil and Leh. But you will be continuing your journey in Srinagar to Leh bus that you hopped on day 3. And of course, you may miss to visit the Lamayuru Monastery when you are travelling by public transport. Hence, the cost of travel on day 4 is Rs. 0 as you have already covered it on day 3. Now for the cost of stay, you can easily find a guest house or a homestay in Leh ranging from Rs 800 to Rs 1000. So you can consider Rs 400 to 500 for a cost of stay in Leh on double sharing basis. Hence, at the end of day 4, the total cost of travel and stay on your budget trip to Ladakh by public transport is Rs 3450 to Rs 3800. On day 5, it will be your rest day in Leh and you will be acclimatizing your body for the high altitude. Here, you are not left with many options of travel but to either get a scooter or a bike on rent, which will cost you around Rs 1000 to Rs 1200, or you can hire a local shared tourist taxi for local sightseeing tour that might cost you around Rs 700 per seat. It is important that you rest on this day to avoid any AMS. On day 5, the cost of travel is Rs 700 for a shared taxi tour of local Leh town. The cost of stay, as we have already discussed, you can consider Rs 400 to 500 for a stay in Leh. Hence, at the end of day 5, the total cost spent on transport and accommodation is Rs 4550 to Rs 5000. On day 6, you will start your Ladakh sightseeing and you will move from Leh to Nubra Valley first. Tourist share taxis are available to travel for a 2-day trip to Nubra Valley from Leh, which costs around Rs 2000. You will also get public share taxis as well for Nubra Valley near Polo Ground in Leh at Rs 600 only, so the return cost will be around Rs 1200 only by public share taxis. Similarly, within Nubra Valley, you can travel by shared taxis for around Rs 400, but it will be a bit inconvenient if you plan to travel too many places within Nubra Valley. Also, if you are lucky, you can get a JKSRTC state transport bus to Diskit, which costs just Rs 250, which means only 500 rupees for a return. However, it depends on the bus if that is running on the day of your travel or not. Now, for the cost of travel, you will be spending Rs 1600 for a Leh to Nubra Valley to Leh trip, considering you will opt for public share taxis. Now for the cost of stay, you can easily find a guest house or a homestay in Nubra Valley at Hundar or Diskit, ranging from Rs 800 to Rs 1000. So you can consider Rs 400 to 500 for a stay in Nubra Valley. Hence, at the end of day 6, the total transport and accommodation cost is around Rs 6550 to Rs 7000. On day 7, you will be returning from Nubra Valley to Leh, and cost of return travel we have already considered on day 6. Now for the cost of stay, you already know that in Leh you can easily get around Rs 400 to 500 per night stay. Hence, at the end of day 7, the total expenses of transport and accommodation is Rs 6950 to Rs 7500. On day 8, you will be traveling from Leh to Pangong So Lake. Tourist share taxis are available to travel for a 2-day trip to Pangong So from Leh, costing about Rs 2000 per seat. However, assuming you started your trip on a Friday evening from Delhi, it will be Saturday on this day. Hence, you can also get a JKSRTC bus at only Rs 600 for a return journey from Pangong So to Leh. So, the cost of travel for day 8 and day 9 is Rs 600 for a return, considering you get a JKSRTC bus to Pangong So scheduled on a Saturday. Now for the cost of stay, you can easily find a homestay or dormitory tents at Pangong So at Rs 500 to Rs 600 per person per day. So you can consider Rs 500 for a stay at Pangong So. Of course, the cost of stay will be much higher in case you plan to stay in tents with attached toilets or better guest houses with attached bathrooms. But I am assuming that you are on a budget trip to Ladakh, so you'll be okay with staying at homestays. Hence, at the end of day 8, the total cost of travel and stay on your trip to Ladakh by using public transport is Rs 8050 to Rs 8600. Now on day 9, you will be returning from Pangong So to Leh, and we have already considered the cost of travel for this day, and for the stay in Leh, you already know that it will be around Rs 400 to 500. Hence, at the end of day 9, the total cost spent on transport and accommodation is Rs 8450 to Rs 9100. Now on day 10, you will be traveling from Leh to Somori Lake, and tourist share taxis are available to travel for a 2-day trip to Somori from Leh, costing about Rs 2800. Also, there is a JKSRTC bus that runs on every 10th, 20th and 30th day of the month from Leh to Somori and costs just about Rs 800 for a return ticket. If you are lucky enough and the dates clash on these days, you can consider saving about Rs 1200 in overall budget. So for the cost of travel for day 10 and day 11 is Rs 2800, considering you will be taking a shared taxi in case your dates do not match the dates of JKSRTC bus to Somori from Leh. Now for the cost of stay, you can easily find a guest house or a homestay at Somori ranging from Rs 800 to 1000, so you can consider Rs 400 to 500 for a stay at Somori homestays. Of course, the cost of tented accommodations with attached washroom are much higher in comparison to homestays. Hence, at the end of day 10, the total transport and accommodation cost is Rs 11,650 to Rs 12,400. On day 11, you will return to Leh from Somori. We have already considered the cost of travel for this day, and for stay in Leh, you know that it will cost you around Rs 400 to 500. Hence, at the end of day 11, the total expenses for transport and accommodation is Rs 12,050 to Rs 12,900. On day 12, you will start your return journey to home via Manali, and you will find plenty of options to travel on this route. Daily HRTC buses are available to travel to Kelong on the first day, the second day to Manali and third day to Delhi. However, there is a direct bus to Delhi from Leh by HRTC which costs around just Rs 1400 and that covers the journey in 2 days with the overnight halt at Kelong. The buses are also available up to Kelong and Manali as well. Also, there is an HPTTC tourist bus that stops at all tourist sightseeing places on Manali-Leh Highway and takes an overnight halt at Kelong, but it costs a little more higher than the regular ones. Finally, lots of shared taxis options are also available, both local as well as tourist ones. But for this example, we'll consider direct HRTC bus to Delhi from Leh via Kelong and Manali, which will cost just around Rs 1400. Now for the cost of stay, you can easily find a guest house or a homestay in Kelong ranging from Rs 800 to Rs 1000. So you can consider Rs 400 to 500 for a stay in Kelong. Hence, at the end of day 12, the total cost of travel and stay is Rs 13,850 to Rs 14,800. Now finally, on day 13, you will complete the trip to Delhi from Kelong via Manali in the same HRTC bus that you onboarded from Leh on day 12. At the end of this itinerary, the total cost of transport and accommodation on your budget trip to Ladakh by public transport is Rs 13,850 to Rs 14,800. Friends, so far we have just talked about the cost of travel and cost of stay, but what about the cost of food? The food all over Ladakh is quite economic unless you wish to lavishly spend in restaurants in Leh and Manali. If you eat at regular dhabas where the buses or the shared taxis stop and do not wish to go into high-end restaurants in Leh or Manali, you will not be spending more than Rs 300 to Rs 350 per day on food. Taking this factor into account, the above 13-day road trip to Ladakh may not cost you more than ₹3,900 to ₹4,550 for the food cost. Hence, with this food cost known to us now, the total cost of Ladakh trip by public transport comes out to be ₹17,750 to ₹19,350, which is well under 20,000. So friends, you can see that if you are really lucky or plan carefully to get public transport buses within Ladakh as well as to Somori Lake, you may consider saving much more, making a budget trip to Ladakh possible well under ₹16,500 only. And in case you drop Somori Lake from the plan and only travel to Pangong So and Nubra Valley, then you can very much make a Ladakh trip by public transport possible on a budget of ₹15,000 approximately. At the end of it, I'm sure you can use this example to fit your own custom plan. It will give you the confidence for making a budget trip to Ladakh by public transport well under a budget of ₹17,000 that includes places like Srinagar Leh Highway, Manali Leh Highway, Nubra Valley, Pangong So and Somori Lake.
Self-planning or package? Well, with self-planning, you can save a lot. So it costs you less than half of what you're spending on a package. For example, my package through Thomas Cook for a solo traveler cost me around 48,000. So package is always expensive, but like I said, they plan everything. The risk factor is not there. Luxury is there.
आप लद्दाख का ट्रिप जो है खुद से बिना किसी ट्रैवल एजेंट के, बिना किसी ऑनलाइन ट्रैवल एजेंट के प्लान कर भी सकते हो, नहीं कर सकते हो? तो देखो दोस्तों, इसका आंसर भी मैं यही देना चाहूंगा कि पर्सन टू पर्सन डिपेंड करेगा कि आप किस तरह के ट्रैवलर हो, क्या आप वेबसाइट्स वगैरह पे रिसर्च करना चाहते हो जहाँ पे पूरी मात्रा में जो लद्दाख का ट्रिप सक्सेसफुली आप प्लान कैसे कर सकते हो, प्लान आइटनरी क्या होनी चाहिए, कब जाना चाहिए, होटल्स के कॉन्टैक्ट, टैक्सीज के कॉन्टैक्ट, सब कुछ अवेलेबल है। क्या आप थोड़ा बहुत टाइम स्पेंड करना चाहते हो, क्या आप ऐसी पर्सनैलिटी हो ट्रैवलर की जो थोड़ा रिसर्च करके और ये सब जानकारी ले के ट्रैवल करते हो, तो भाई आप बिल्कुल खुद से ट्रैवल कर सकते हो। बट कुछ पर्सनालिटीज़ ऐसी होती हैं ट्रैवलिंग की कि भाई उनको कोई इस बातों से लेना देना नहीं है, उनको रिसर्च नहीं करना है। तो अगर आप सेकंड वाली कैटेगरी में हो कि भाई आपको ज़्यादा रिसर्च नहीं करनी, बस एंजॉय करना है ट्रिप को जाके, तो आप आउटसोर्स कर सकते हो। आप कोई जो ट्रैवल पैकेज है ऑनलाइन ट्रैवल एजेंट से वो खरीद सकते हो, या फिर आप जो ऑलरेडी ये शेयर्ड पैकेजेस वगैरह चलते हैं काफ़ी सारे, उनमें अपने आप, अगर आप सोलो हो या फिर एज अ कपल ट्रैवलर हो, तो आप उनमें ज्वाइन कर सकते हो, सीट बुक कर सकते हो और ट्रैवल कर सकते हो। या फिर आप जो बुटीक ट्रैवल एजेंट्स हैं जो कि आपको कस्टमाइज आइटनरी देंगे, आपके नीड के हिसाब से होटल्स देंगे, लग्जरी, नॉन लग्जरी, स्टैंडर्ड, होम स्टेज, चीप, अगर आपको कस्टमाइज टूर प्लानिंग करनी है तो वो भी आप कर सकते हो। बट डिपेंड करता है कि आप किस तरह की पर्सनालिटी हो। और अगर आपको कस्टमाइज टूर्स चाहिए जो कि बिल्कुल बुटीक प्लानिंग करते हैं लद्दाख के ट्रिप्स की, तो कैन भाई जो अपना अनप्लग्ड लाइफ नाम से ट्रैवल एजेंसी चलाते हैं लद्दाख में, उनसे बेहतर आपको शायद ही कोई मिलेगा। बहुत ही बढ़िया है, अगर आपको जाना है तो आप उनके थ्रू जा सकते हैं। पहले पॉइंट की अगर बात करें कि अगर आप खुद से प्लानिंग कर रहे हो अपनी लद्दाख ट्रिप की, तो आपके हाथ में कंट्रोल है सारा का सारा। क्या आइटनरी होनी चाहिए, कितने दिन होने चाहिए, किस प्लान को आपको फॉलो करना है, क्या अकोमोडेशन लेना है, किस लेवल का लेना है, कौन से स्टेज होने चाहिए, क्या क्या साइट सीइंग करोगे, कहाँ कहाँ पे रुकोगे, कहाँ ड्राइवर बुक करोगे, कहाँ पे खुद जाओगे, जो कुछ भी प्लानिंग है आप खुद से कर सकते हो। बट डाउनसाइड क्या है इस पॉइंट का, वो ये है कि भाई आपको टाइम इन्वेस्ट करना पड़ेगा, आपको मेरे जैसे जो चैनल हैं उसके ऊपर टाइम लगाना पड़ेगा, वीडियोस देखने पड़ेंगे, थोड़ा रिसर्च करना पड़ेगा, थोड़ा समझना पड़ेगा, फिर आप मुझसे क्वेश्चन पूछ सकते हैं, मैं आपकी हेल्प कर सकता हूँ। बट टाइम इन्वेस्टमेंट जरूर है। बट अगर आप पैकेज खरीदते हो तो आपको पीस ऑफ माइंड मिलता है कि भाई आपके पास में एक सिंगल पॉइंट ऑफ कॉन्टैक्ट होगा जिसको आप फोन लगाओगे और बोलोगे भाई ये दिक्कत आ रही है, सही करो, फिक्स करो, मुझे ये नहीं मिल रहा। अब उसका सिर दर्द है, आपको नहीं देखना है, क्योंकि पहले वाले प्लान में अगर फ्लेक्सिबिलिटी नहीं रखी हुई है ऑन स्पॉट बुकिंग की, लेट सपोज, तो भाई जो आपने होटल बुक कराया, अब आपको उससे चेंज कराने की नौबत आई, रोड ब्लॉक हो गया, तो आपको उससे फ़ोन पे लड़ना पड़ेगा, बात करनी पड़ेगी, समझाना पड़ेगा कि भाई ये प्रॉब्लम हो गई है, मैं नहीं आ रहा हूँ, तो वो सारी डीलिंग आपको करनी पड़ेगी, अगेन टाइम की बात है। बट अगर आपने पैकेज टूर बुक करा हुआ है और कंडीशंस में है कि आप चेंजेस वगैरह कर सकते हो, तो आप भाई अपने ट्रैवल एजेंट को फ़ोन करोगे जो भी बीच में इन्वॉल्व है, और वो उसका सिर दर्द है आप सब कुछ मैनेज करना ना। गाड़ी वाड़ी ख़राब होती है उसका सिर दर्द है, अपने आप से प्लान कर रहे होगे, बीच में गाड़ी ख़राब होगी तो ऑफकोर्स जो ड्राइवर है वो आपकी हेल्प करेगा, बट थोड़ा सा जो है आपके ऊपर भी आ जाता है कि हाँ भाई आप ओपन होने चाहिए उस तरह की फ्लेक्सिबिलिटी के लिए, मैं बोलूँगा सर्कमस्टांसिस के लिए। दूसरा पॉइंट जो है, जो मैं पर्सनली फॉलो करता हूँ, मैं हमेशा अपनी ट्रिप जो है खुद से प्लान करता हूँ, चाहे कहीं भी कर रहा हूँ, तो इसमें एडवांटेज क्या है? क्या मुझे पसंद नहीं है कि भाई सिंगल पॉइंट ऑफ कॉन्टैक्ट हो, पीसफुल रहूं, भाई जाऊं सीधा घूम के वापस आ जाऊं, जो जो पॉइंट्स टूर एजेंट ने दिखाने हैं वो देखूं, उन्हीं पॉइंट्स को सिर्फ एंजॉय करके टूर पैकेज का मज़ा उठा के वापस आ जाऊं? तो बिल्कुल दोस्तों, मेरा भी कई बार मन करता है, बट मेजॉरिटी 90% ऑफ द टाइम मैं खुद से प्लान करता हूं। 10% ट्रिप्स मैं ऐसी ज़रूर रखता हूं जहां पे मुझे कोई सिरदर्द नहीं चाहिए, बस फैमिली के साथ जाऊं, एक स्पॉट पे रुकूं, वहां पे एंजॉय करूं, वापस आ जाऊं। और उस तरह की अगर कोई ट्रिप मुझे करनी है तो ज़रूर मैं हो सकता है किसी ट्रैवल एजेंट की हेल्प ले लूं। बट ऐसा क्यों करता हूं? ऐसा इसलिए करता हूं क्योंकि जब भी आप खुद से प्लानिंग करते हो तो आप खुद अपना टाइम इन्वेस्ट कर रहे हो, आप उस प्लेस के बारे में समझ रहे हो, चीज़ों के बारे में समझ रहे हो, लोकल कल्चर के बारे में समझ रहे हो, लोकल रीजन की जो ज्योग्राफी है उसके बारे में समझ रहे हो कि भाई कैसे जा सकते हैं, कहाँ जा सकते हैं, कहाँ नहीं जा सकते, लद्दाख के अंदर एक्लिमेटाइजेशन क्यों है, ये सब बातें आप जानते हो, आप लोकल से खुद बात करते हो, खुद कनेक्शन होता है आपका। ऐसा नहीं है ट्रैवल एजेंट ने होटल बुक करा हुआ है, सीधा ब्रीफ केस उठाए होटल में गए और सीधा ब्रीफ केस उठाए वहां से बाहर निकल गए, क्योंकि आपने खुद बात करी है, आप दो चार जाके आप बातें करोगे तो आप जो है पर्सनली ज़्यादा कनेक्टेड फील करते हो उस प्लेस से जहाँ पे आप ट्रैवल कर रहे होते हो। और लॉन्ग टर्म में ये काफ़ी बेनिफिशियल होता है क्योंकि जो पर्सनल कनेक्शन बनता है प्लेस के साथ में वो डिफरेंट है, और वही जो चीज़ है मैं छोड़ना नहीं चाहता हूँ, इसलिए मैं खुद से हमेशा अपने सारे ट्रिप्स जो हैं वो प्लान करता हूँ। जब भी आप हिमालय में ट्रैवल करते हो तो पूरी रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी के साथ ट्रैवल करो और वहाँ पे कूड़ा कचरा जो है वो मत फैलाओ। और इसी का इनडायरेक्ट एडवांटेज ये हो जाता है क्योंकि आप लोकल से डायरेक्टली डील कर रहे हो, कोई बीच में मिडलमैन नहीं है, तो भाई आप उस लोकल की डायरेक्टली मदद कर रहे हो, उस लोकल का अपलिफ्टमेंट कर रहे हो, उसके घर का, उसके बिजनेस का। तो वो भी एक बहुत अहम मुद्दा है या अहम पॉइंट है, मैं बोलूँगा अहम एडवांटेज है, जो आप लोकल कम्युनिटी को वापस दे रहे हो एज अ टूरिस्ट। और ये जो लोकल है सिर्फ होटल तक लिमिटेड नहीं है, आप टैक्सी ड्राइवर से लोकली कनेक्ट कर रहे हो, वो टैक्सी ड्राइवर आपको लोकल ढाबे पे लेके जाएंगे जहाँ पे आप खाना खाओगे, या लोकल जो भी जगहें आएंगी उन पे लेके जाएंगे जहाँ खाना वाना खाओगे, तो पूरी इकोनॉमी जो है लोकल्स की उस पे डिपेंड हो जाती है। जब आप टूर एजेंट के थ्रू चलते हो तो कमीशन मॉडल कहीं पर आ जाता है, मैं बोलूँगा टैक्सी के अंदर भी, होटल के अंदर भी, तो जो मिडल मैन है वो थोड़ा सा ऑफकोर्स अपना टाइम इन्वेस्ट कर रहा है, वो आपसे पैसे ज़रूर लेगा सर्विसेज के, राइट, इसमें कुछ गलत नहीं है, पर आप अगर डायरेक्टली लोकल से कनेक्ट कर रहे हो तो सारा शेयर उसके पास में जा रहा है। अगेन मैं बिल्कुल नहीं कह रहा हूँ कि अगर आप बुक्ड टूर से जाते हो या प्री बुकिंग करके जाते हो तो वो गलत बात है, बट मैं आपको तुलना करके दिखा रहा हूँ कि भाई अगर आप प्री प्लानिंग से जा रहे हो या प्री बुकिंग से जा रहे हो और आप खुद से प्लान करके जा रहे हो तो दोनों में डिफरेंस क्या है। और फाइनली इस पॉइंट को अगर क्लोज करूं तो आपकी लद्दाख की ट्रिप जो है आप खुद से प्लान ज़रूर कर सकते हो, बट आपको एडवांटेजेस और डिसएडवांटेजेस जो है उनको तोलना मोलना होगा, और जो राइट डिसीजन है आपके लिए आपको उसको लेना होगा।
Hot booking or pre-booking hotels. Now, Leh city has lot of hotels, lot of choice for you. But during high season, availability of accommodation may be a bit difficult. In that case, you have to book the accommodation in advance. During monsoons, autumn and winter, I think it is fairly easy to just walk in and get a room. But you should know which hotel to choose, which is the best option, which has the high rating. All those things you can study online. Dheeraj Sharma's video has a lot of guidance on how to go about it.
Are you confused if you should do the hotel bookings in advance or should you book the hotels on the spot after reaching Leh Ladakh? Or are you worried that if you will even get the hotels on the spot when you reach Leh Ladakh? Or will doing on-spot booking save you enough money? Or will it save any money if you book all the hotels in advance? What are the advantages and disadvantages of making an on-spot booking on a Ladakh trip? These are some of the common questions people ask me on travel blog. Well, clearly there are some advantages and some disadvantages of both these options. And today in this Express FAQ series on traveling to Ladakh, I'm going to talk about it in detail. So let's get started. Well, it is a personal choice to go to Ladakh trip with pre-booking done, or if you plan to do bookings on the spot. What I suggest in general is that if you do not plan to stay at any specific hotels, or if you are okay with searching the place a bit upon reaching there, then I feel that you could save some money if you don't book hotels in advance. Of course, you cannot be too finicky about cleanliness and comfort. As long as you are okay with some basic cleanliness and decent comfort for you or the family, I believe it is completely okay to do on-spot bookings and save some money. Personally speaking, I have traveled to Ladakh in the group of like 3-4 people as well as 60 odd people, and I do not recall any situation where we could not manage the on-spot bookings. The best part of all these trips was that I was able to save decent amount of money when booking them on the spot. Apart from getting a lower rate on the spot, many of the stay options will offer you 3 additional person, or at times they may also allow you to sleep maybe like 4 people in one big room, and such things will definitely help you save 25-30% on your budget for hotels on a Ladakh trip. Now secondly, if you're not doing pre-bookings, it also provides you much more flexibility in terms of date as you reach to a particular place. This flexibility, which allows you last minute changes in places like Ladakh or Spiti Valley or remote corners of Ladakh, it is completely precious. In such places, the road conditions are very uncertain and enough to force a change in plan. So for me, the flexibility always stays on top of the list when planning a Ladakh trip. It is not only the road closures, but who knows that you fall in love with the place so much that you would like to skip another location from the trip altogether. And it has happened to me numerous times. And each time, the flexibility in the plan without having any kind of pre-booking helped me a lot adjust my travel plan in Ladakh. Thirdly, most local homestays may not be available online for bookings. If you are a homestay person or like to enjoy the local hospitality, then you will find most of the authentic homestays when you arrive at that place. I know there could be plenty of travel agents who can help you with those bookings, but keep in mind that if you book them on the spot, the entire profit goes to the homestay owner without any commission to the travel agent. This will certainly help those locals in need, and who knows that you may end up with a friend of a life at such a humble place in the Himalayas. Now you must be wondering if it is that easy to find a place to stay on the spot in Leh-Ladakh. Well, finding a place is not that difficult in Leh-Ladakh if you are accommodating with little things here and there. And if you are traveling with taxi, most of the taxi drivers will be able to help you out with the stay options. But even if you are planning on your own or self-driving, you can manage it easily as well. Unless you are too particular about a place to sleep and stay, or you want a particular hotel or a camp, in general, it should be completely okay to book on the spot and have these advantages to yourself. For a reference, you can always keep a list of good stay options in Leh-Ladakh, which is available on Devil on Wheels blog, handy with you. Take a printout of it, keep it saved on your phone. To ease your job, I have provided the link to my series of articles about good stay options in Ladakh in the description of this video. And finally, one very important pro travel tip. I always carry my personal sleeping bag everywhere where I travel. It helps me adjust to many places with many situations and many stay options. Even when it is a small basic homestay or a dhaba tent or a camp, I'm always comfortable with my sleeping bag. Well, sometimes you might not like the blankets and the quilts provided by these homestays and small guest houses. In that case, if you have your own sleeping bag, you don't need to worry much about that. Plus, it also acts as an additional layer of protection from cold in the shoulder months of Ladakh season. Again, there is nothing wrong with the advance booking, and I know a lot of people prefer to do it, but I still feel that on-the-spot booking deal saves you a decent enough money in Ladakh. Plus, it gives you an opportunity to keep your plan flexible and cherish and contribute to the local homestay hospitality much better.
Then taking your aged parents, pets, asthmatics and kids, this is a very sensitive point, because some people would like to take their aged parents along with. Well, I don't consider myself as aged, though I am a senior citizen. I can mingle with any kind of people, any age group, and I can face any challenge. I got that great because I have traveled a lot, and I have also done trekking, but not many people are designed like me, and some cannot leave their pets at home. They want to take them. So what all things they have to consider, they have to take care of, they can get guided here. So asthmatics. Asthmatics have their own prescribed therapy and precautions to take. I don't say asthmatics don't go to Ladakh or never visit Ladakh. Lot of them go there, but they have to take certain precautions. Then taking kids. Well, kids may or may not enjoy Ladakh trip. Two small kids may not enjoy, because a lot of journey is included. Rough terrain is covered, bumpy roads, off-roading. Though most of the roads are very well maintained by Border Roads Organization or BRO, Still, there are many places where often there will be landslides, because Himalayan range and the Karakoram range, they are all young mountains. Landslides and shooting stones, it is a common scene there. And especially during monsoons, there will be flooding. Though Ladakh is called a rain shadow region, there are sometimes cloudbursts. Like in 2010 it happened. Then recently, last year itself it happened, before I went there. There was flooding in Leh city. A lot of slush and mud on the road and landslides. So it is a common thing there. Because the snow that settles on the mountain melts during summer and rainy season. And that, comes down. And along with the flow of water, shooting stones and landslides happen. And highways are devastated. Road surfacing cannot be maintained in immaculate condition throughout the year. So after winter, when the roads open, there will be a lot of incidences of landslides and shooting stones there. Flooding also happens in many places. So all these factors you have to keep in mind.
A lot of people ask me about if they can make a trip to Ladakh or other high altitude places with their old age parents. Well, as I have already talked in many of my other videos, acute mountain sickness or AMS does not matter concerning of any age, gender or physical fitness. It can happen to anyone of any age, gender or fitness level. So yes, as much as you can go yourself to Ladakh, you can surely take your parents, provided they are in healthy condition and can endure the fatigue and this long journey. And you can follow few tips that I have mentioned in this video to make a trip memorable for them. Number one, you should always plan a relaxing and a comfortable itinerary for your Ladakh trip when you are taking an elder parent with you. Secondly, you should travel from Srinagar Leh Highway with night halts at Kargil and Alchi. This will help a lot in acclimatization before you reach high altitude of Leh. And then, after doing all the sightseeing in Ladakh, you can come via Manali Leh Highway. And to be on safe side, on Manali Leh Highway, you can sleep at Jispa instead of Sarju. Thirdly, plan to hire a comfortable vehicle, as a lot of distance needs to be travelled on this Ladakh trip. Fourthly, it is needless to say that everyone in the group should be adequately hydrated to combat AMS. And most importantly, if they are on a medication or have any kind of existing illness, make sure you consult your doctor. And only after your doctor's approval, travel to high altitude places by carrying proper medication and his advice. Otherwise, medical help could be hard to find in remote regions of Ladakh. So please take your doctor's advice very seriously. Many times people ask me if a person suffering from asthma can visit Ladakh or Spiti Valley or other high altitude places. Well, you must be wondering, I'm not a doctor. But yeah, my blog gets a lot of hits where people ask me this question. So I do have some suggestion on this topic based on the experience of people shared on the blog and the DOW forums. Firstly, if you are suffering from asthma, then before taking any decision on traveling to places like Ladakh, Spiti Valley or other high altitude regions, I highly recommend that you consult your doctor. He will be able to best guide you for this trip. Otherwise, as a guideline, people with asthma issues are mostly okay to travel to Ladakh or other high altitude places because of purity of air and less pollution. If you think asthma is mainly related to the pollution and dust mites, which are a common allergen, these are present rarely at high altitude places like Ladakh and Spiti Valley. So it is assumed that people with asthma issues may do just fine in Ladakh or Spiti Valley as well. Do not take this as a medical advice. It is a question that you must consult with your doctor before traveling to high altitude regions like Ladakh and Spiti Valley. Are you also considering a family trip to Leh Ladakh with your dog or a pet? Well, as travel industry is booming in India, more and more hotels are becoming pet friendly and welcoming pets. And the same is true for Ladakh tourism industry as well. In fact, hotels in Ladakh even provide food for pets. So, before making the bookings of your hotel, do ask your hotels or camps if they can help you with the food for your dog or pet. Otherwise, you can always choose to carry your own food. Always remember, as you will do it to yourself, do keep your pets or dogs adequately hydrated, as it forms the basis of acclimatization for any living being. Also, it is very obvious, but still, do consult your veterinary doctor before undertaking any trips to high altitude places in the Himalayas like Ladakh, Spiti Valley or Zanskar Valley. You should ask your doctor about any medicine for motion sickness or high altitude sickness that they may like to prescribe. Finally, make sure that you always carry your pet's vaccination records with you on all your trips. They may come very handy in case the situation demands for. Needless to say, go well prepared for your Leh-Ladakh road trip.
If you are suffering from hypertension or high blood pressure, then before taking any decision on traveling to Ladakh or other high altitude places, please do consult your doctor. Whenever asked, even my answer to this question is pretty tricky. Why? Because a lot of variables go into controlling the blood pressure. In general, people with controlled blood pressure at low altitudes with medication or without medication are assumed to do just fine on high altitude. Still, I highly recommend a consultation from a doctor is absolutely required and you should never ignore it. Well, usually there will be an increase in your blood pressure as you reach high altitude places like Ladakh or Spiti Valley. It is because of the lack of oxygen that infuses stress and adrenaline in the body. The high blood pressure subsides over a period of time as you stay at the high altitude, but usually it takes about 1 to 2 weeks when your body is like acclimatized to the rarefied oxygen over there. However, by no means you should alter your dosage of medication that you are already taking without any consultation with your doctor. Hence, if you have hypertension or high blood pressure, then you must consult your doctor before making a call to travel to Ladakh, Spiti Valley, Zanskar Valley or other high altitude places in the Himalayas.
Are you planning a Leh-Ladakh road trip with your family, having kids who are like less than 5 years old? Is it even possible to take small kids on a Leh-Ladakh road trip? Well, a lot of people ask me about if they can make a Leh-Ladakh road trip with their 2 or 3 year old small kid or a baby. AMS does not matter concerning age or gender or any fitness level. So it can happen to anyone of any age or gender or fitness level. Personally speaking, I'll not take a child who is less than 5 year old kid to a high altitude place in remote Himalayas like Ladakh or Spiti Valley or Zanskar Valley. I will wait for them to grow older and then I'll take them along with me. You must remember that no matter how much they sell it, Leh Ladakh is not a family or a leisure destination. It is an adventure travel destination and it will remain as is. And as you know my friend, adventure always comes with risk. And personally, I will prefer not to take any risk with such a young child or a toddler. And above all, before you make a call to take such a small baby to a high altitude place like Ladakh or Spiti Valley, please consult your child's pediatric doctor and follow his medical advice. Also, let me share a couple of major pointers why I do not recommend to do it. Firstly, the issue with the small kids of any age group is that they tend to exert body, they will play around, they will jump around. They don't consider it a different place. For them, it is a place that they belong to. And as they exert more, this elevates the chances of getting hit with AMS. Number two, the children with such an age group are not much expressive about their uneasy feelings. So it is the parents who needs to watch out for the child's behavior and take care that the child is not suffering from any uneasy feelings or headache or nausea and is behaving properly. With less than 5 year old kid, I believe that he or she will not be able to convey those uneasy feelings. So you have to be very vigilant. Even if for any reason you plan to travel to Ladakh with such a small kid or a toddler, which I don't recommend, at least follow the advice to travel Ladakh from Srinagar Leh Highway with overnight halts at Kargil and Alchi. This will help you with the acclimatization and watch out how the child is behaving. Then if all goes well within Ladakh, come back via Manali Leh Highway, and while coming from Manali Leh Highway, try to avoid sleeping at Sarchu, instead sleep at Jaspa. Sarchu is a remote region with less medical facilities and higher altitude. It is an adventure travel destination and will always remain that way. And adventure always comes with some risk. Hence, when you are traveling to remote corners of Himalaya, especially the high altitude places like Ladakh, Spiti Valley or Zanskar Valley, you must follow certain precautions. And if you are traveling with kids who are like more than 5 years of age, well then, go well prepared for the trip. But above all, before making any call to take your kid to such a high altitude place like Ladakh or Spiti Valley, please consult your child's pediatric doctor and follow his medical advice. Still, it is parents' job to watch out and take care that children is not suffering from any uneasy feelings like headache or nausea and is behaving properly. If you notice any such feeling or he or she tells you about such a feeling, then please do not ascend anywhere. Either descend to a lower altitude or stay at the same place to watch out things overnight.
If the symptoms increases, then start descending immediately. And the same principle applies to any adult as well. If you found this video helpful, please do not forget to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my YouTube channel. And if you need any help or have any questions on your upcoming trip to the Himalayas, please feel free to leave a comment down below and I'll be more than happy to help you out right away. Till then, my friends, jule and keep our Himalayas clean.
I hope Dheeraj's video inputs helped you in planning your next trip to Ladakh. I was benefited very much. I'm very much thankful to Dheeraj. Dheeraj, you are a great man. You have a great attitude, you are a helping person, and your response to your followers, your viewers is something fantastic. Dheeraj replies all your questions immediately without wasting time. Though he is placed in the United States of America, he is a techie working there. He has his own team in Ladakh and Himachal who provide him information about everything, the weather, the road, the accommodation, the taxis, all these information he gets through them. So he educates people, he guides people. Do subscribe to his channel, Dheeraj Sharma on YouTube. And also follow his blog, Discover with Dheeraj Sharma. With a big thanks to Dheeraj, I am concluding this special episode. Things to know before you visit Leh-Ladakh. Thank you very much. Namaste, Julie. See you all in the next episode.